This is Kathleen McGuigan of Architectural Record, and this is part two of our conversation with Neri Oxman, the architect and thinker who is radically reinterpreting the relationship between design and nature through her interdisciplinary research platform at the MIT Media Lab. So, Neri, if you would be so kind, just start a little bit by telling us a little bit how you set up your work and describe your lab and describe your interdisciplinary team.
So we think of our group at the lab a little bit as a Noah's Ark, two of everyone. So architects, mechanical engineers, material scientists, biologists and synthetic biologists, chemists, marine biologists. And they all come together to work and to study. We think of our research program as a kind of a vertical lens, a microscope that enables us to study materials, material systems, and invent technologies to recreate these material systems in new ways and follow from the principles of material ecology.
Any lab, I imagine there's a lot of trial and error. You've got an enormous range of species at your disposal, so you're trying things all the time. And is there some mystery involved?
The project starts with mystery. The project starts with a question. It is not about problem solving, but it is more about problem seeking. How can we invent tools or technologies to problems we may not know yet exist? And so process is just important as product, perhaps more so. And what's very special about our lab is that I do not believe that we've created any product or building structure for which we have not invented a technology, whether it's a robotic arm or whether it's a new computational platform that is attached to an already existing 3D printer. These are all new tools, techniques, and technologies that were developed by the group in the context of a new project. What started as the design of a biocompatible product can then enter the architectural scale in the design of a biocompatible architectural pavilion.
When you're talking about structures, another fascinating project is the project you've done more than once with silkworms. Here is an organism, an animal, an insect that has created something absolutely lovely we wear. I had no idea until I read about it that in the making of silk, the silkworms are boiled alive in their little cocoons after they've done their spinning, and it kills them.
The hero of the silk industry that is used and it's fair to say abused to create much of the textiles, the silk textiles that we wear. And in the process of creating silk, those silk cocoons are boiled to separate between two types of chemical components, sericin and fibrin. Fibrin is the material that is the fibrous material that is in charge of the fibers in the silk fiber. And sericin is the glue, the matrix-like material that glues those fibers together. Each cocoon about a kilometer, yes, believe it or not. And so when we created the first silk pavilion, little did we know, but by we FedEx ordered 6,500 silkworms that that worked together with us to build the cocoon. This was the length of the Silk Road, 6,500 kilometers. But here what's interesting is, we asked ourselves, can we cohabitate and fabricate with an organism that so beautifully and elegantly and meticulously transcends all of the constraints of additive manufacturing as we know them? Here we have silk, which is one of the most superior materials that we know. We have an organism that builds a cocoon, an architecture that's bigger than the size of itself. The silkworm is able to spin these incredible architectural objects in three dimensions, not by layering, not by milling, not by laminating. There is a huge intelligence that is coupled with the process of spinning these cocoons. And when we experimented with these silkworms and placed them on our lab desk, we found that they go about spinning the 1 kilometer of silk as a patch, as opposed to a three-dimensional cocoon. So in the absence of a tree branch, in the absence of a vertical axis that is less than 21 millimeters, that is the magical threshold, the silkworm will go about spinning its cocoon, but it will be a flat patch as opposed to a three-dimensional object. And what's great about this process is that the silkworm will healthily metamorphosize without the need to boil the cocoon and kill the silkworm, the larva. And so we've utilized this process in the design of a 6 meter tall and 5 meter wide architectural structure utilizing 17,532 silkworms. The underlying structure is made of water-soluble knit. And so as the silkworms were populating the structure, they have gone about their natural metamorphosis, and their excretions actually contributed to the melting of some of the water-soluble knit, the underlying armature, and creating holes in the knit. And those holes released residual energy that was caught inside the structure, residual energy that we had to find a way to release and was later released by virtue of using, you know, collaborating with the silkworm itself. So metabolic forces literally relieving structural mechanical forces.
That's one of the surprises that nature sometimes introduces into your otherwise very controlled lab.
Much of our work, especially in the product scale, involved questions around, you know, what does it mean to design living products and living building materials? We needed to create materials that are structurally sound, completely transparent, so that we can control the amount of light that goes through them for the purposes of photosynthesis and other light relevant biological processes, and also materials that are chemically inert. That generated the first of its kind glass printer. So when you blow glass, form glass, or press glass, usually the interior and exterior features are of the same geometry. But when you're printing glass, you can control the geometry of the interior features independently of the geometry of the exterior features. And so the glass printer began with these studies of how can we create optical lenses in architectural and even urban scales to harness solar energy and create pockets, spatial pockets, and channels that can contain living matter. The ultimate expression of material ecology, multifunctional building skins that work both for structure and for environmental filtration without the need to create assemblies and appendages of, let's use concrete, steel, and glass all as an assembly, but rather coming up with material systems that enable you to embody multiple performance criteria in a single material system.